Hello, my darling sweetheart. Happy birthday. Your children have come up with this wonderful surprise, and this is something that they have been working on for a long time to show you how much that they love you.
Happy, happy birthday from all of us to you!
Happy birthday,
5-0! 5-0?
Damn, I hate that you're getting older because it just means that my wife's getting older.
Am I on
here? What else? What do the other kids say about it?
Well, apparently the dog wants to say hello. Say hi, Angel. Say hi to the man.
Happy birthday, Dad! Congratulations!
Can I do it now? Stay. Don't move.
This is kind of an exciting event in life, but being the older brother, I've already gone through this.
We love you, and we both know how it feels to be 50 years old, because collectively, we've been 57 more years.
Remember the morning that David was born. It was in San Bernardino, California. He was 2 weeks late, so we were anxious for him to come.
When Dave came home from the hospital, and that I was so excited to see him that I climbed up on the bassinet, and as I got up there, it went off balance and rolled Uncle Dave into the fireplace where he was covered with ashes. Luckily, there was no fire going.
We had a neighbor named...
Bonnie Jill, and we can't think of her last name.
No.
What was that? Bonnie Jill somebody.
Anyway, she had a red wig, and we took a picture of David as a little boy with the red wig on, and also with a bucket on his head.
Do you remember hearing your dad tell us about he... was driving up into the Sierras. We were going back to California. I guess maybe we were moving back there.
Probably from Idaho Falls.
Right, and David was a little boy, and as Grandpa drove up the very steep hill, David said, "What if Grandpa should have a heart attack now?"
Yeah, my dad didn't really appreciate that. Dan Clifford's wife was casting a musical for our ward. And she asked me, "Do you think your son David would be interested in performing?" And I said, "Way no." I said, "David would never do that." And then, to my great surprise, David was willing to do it and did a remarkable job. He enjoyed it, and it really was fun performing with him.
Did you really sing?
I really sang.
Now, I remember seeing the program, and you both did very well, but I don't remember the singing.
Well, I'm 75 years old. I may not remember correctly.
What can I say about Dave Chesworth? He was always like a brother to me.
When he was young and he first started dating, he wrote a girl a love letter to express his love. And Bob and I thought we should proofread it first, and his spelling was a little off. It started out, "Dear Sweatheart."
I'm my brother's favorite brother. I was supposed to tell a nice story about him, but I can't think of it.
The first memory I have of my brother is taking me to a movie called Dr. Fives, and you must have been about 16 or so. And
I don't have tons of funny stories. I have some stories that he would rather his children that don't hear.
He didn't get in trouble. He was a good boy.
Your dad was a lot rowdier than he'd like you to believe. Back when we were teenagers, it was kind of the thing to do to brown people out and to hang your naked butt out the window while you drive by people. It's kind of a statement. And Dave decided to do it in Escondido. And I was in the car, and we drove by some girls, and Dave stuck his butt out the window, and this girl screamed and screamed like she had just seen a monster. Most people would just laugh or make some comment, but this girl screamed and screamed like something was attacking her. He was a lot rowdier for a while than you'll ever know.
A lot of times he would take us to the beach.
I also remember being taken to a nude beach. I don't know why. We would go to Utah, and you'd be driving in the car, and I'd have to go to the bathroom, and you wouldn't stop and
I've had bladder problems and had to have, you know, several corrective surgeries.
I remember when I was 12 and my mom wanted me to get a paper out and I was too scared. My brother got the paper out for me and then showed me how to do it. And then I had a paper out.
This one time he's pressing a lot of weight. Bench press and a lot of weight, and the two spotters are off talking to each other, they're not watching him, and all of a sudden he loses it and he drops several hundred pounds on his nose and broke it, and that's why his nose looks a little tweaked if you look closely. And he's bleeding all over the place.
I remember an afro perm, which we have pictures of.
And he tried out for the football team, and in practice before the season started, he broke his wrist. He was out for the whole season, but he never got to play football. He's always had trouble with Harleys. I remember when I let him borrow mine to get his driver's license, his motorcycle license, the instructor told him to drive down to the end, go around the cone, and come back. And he promptly stalled the bike and laid it over.
My brother has always enjoyed going fast, and he had a very fast car that I remember. Used to sometimes get caught going faster than he ought to have.
Sometimes got a little rowdy when he was in high school. And he wanted to lay rubber in his GTO. And he was at a four-way stop. So he looked to the left, no sheriffs. Looked to the right, no sheriffs. Looked straight ahead, no sheriffs. And smoked the tires very beautifully. But he never looked in his mirror. And there was the sheriff. He always had trouble with cars, too. He was smashing the front end of the Mustang off or ripping the frames of my station wagon by slamming into the sidewalk. This one time, we were racing an Escondido against a Mustang, and we were over 100, way over 100. And we were shooting up the main street, and a cop came after us, and we pulled over. Dave pulled over. The other guy didn't, and the cop went after him, so we just turned around and left.
Our insurance agent was going to take Dave off the insurance because there were too many tickets, but my father convinced him that Dave could go 2 years without getting any tickets, and I think the man was thinking, well, he can't even go 2 weeks without getting a ticket. But then Dave went on a mission and was able to keep his insurance.
After he came back from his mission to Australia, and what an influence and an impact he was, because it was at that point that I really decided, when I saw how he had changed on his mission and what a good person he was, that I at that point decided that I also wanted to serve a mission. And the difference that that made in my life.
And my sister also had come up at that time and was going to beginning beauty school, and Dave was in our downstairs basement because he needed a haircut. And so she sat him down and used sewing scissors and started cutting his hair, and pretty soon he starts jerking, and she's not knowing what to do until she saw that she had his ear in the scissors, and needless to say, Dave never asked for another haircut from her again.
He visited me at BYU. We went motorcycle riding together, and that was a lot of fun. Just, he came up for a couple days, and it also happened to be the start of the deer hunt, so all the hunters were really mad at us because we were riding up these trails on motorcycles making a lot of noise. And they were very upset at us, but we had a great day. And the deer thanked us for it.
I am so grateful that you are my husband and my sweetheart and my lover and my friend. When I first met you, I thought you were so cute, and I was so excited because one of the cute guys in the ward was my family home evening brother.
He spent so much time with Linda that his roommate came over, I guess, to Linda's apartment and said that he was lonely because Dave didn't spend very much time at home.
I think I somewhat mistakenly encouraged him to date other girls. I said, you shouldn't just date one girl, you should date other girls.
I got to know you. I mean, you were so wonderful, so caring and thoughtful and so spiritual. And I'm so glad the Lord inspired me to marry you and that you were the one I was supposed to marry.
And Linda brought you home and I wanted to impress you because she said she really liked you. So I made pizza. No, I burnt pizza. Store-bought burnt pizza. And it was so sad because every time you came to my house, I would burn pizza.
It was Linda Kurth that stole his heart. And when we met her and came to know her, we were so pleased that she was part of our family.
You promised me if I married you that you would make me happy and that we would have a wonderful future, and you have fulfilled that obligation. The 28 years that we have had together have been the most wonderful years of my life.
That was exciting when they got married in the Salt Lake Temple.
Yeah, that was our first experience in the Salt Lake Temple.
You know, they got engaged rather quickly and were spending months and months, it seemed, to try to find a date when they could get married. And Linda was so frustrated that, you know, one time she just looked at Dave and just told him that the African Americans will hold the priesthood before we ever get married. And let me see if I'm correct. Dave and Linda got married in June of 77, and the African American people were able to receive the priesthood in June of 1978. So they barely beat them.
But we remember that time in the sealing room when they were married, and we were so pleased that they were married in the right place, in the right way.
And then the next year they had baby Michael, and he was such a cute little boy.
You really were such a wonderful young man. You were the answer to every mother's prayer. Do you remember when you would come up in the winter time and you and Tom would take poor little Bill out and do dedicate him to the snow gods?
My fondest memory is being sacrificed to the snow gods on Kensington Avenue. You outweighed me by about 50 pounds in those days. I was a little guy.
You know, he used to read these flying magazines when he was a young teenager, and my dad used to tell him it was just a pipe dream that he would never be a pilot. And he turned out to be a pilot.
It was remarkable that he always wanted to fly.
Yes, just from when he was quite young. But he took his little brothers and sisters down to the airport.
To go down to the airport quite a bit. San Diego Airport, watch the airplanes.
One thing that I admire about my brother Dave is his going after his goals. Very few people that I know have known what they wanted so early in life.
My dad was always one who encouraged me to pursue what I wanted and never discouraged me, never said I couldn't do it. At a time when a lot of my friends were discouraged from their parents.
I've been saving for you for 18 years.
Parents kind of forced them into different majors and running the family business.
That was my first. I wore it in WW2 when I flew with the Cobras. It's great, Dad.
I always knew my dad was behind me. I always knew that my dad supported me, and it gave me the confidence to follow my dreams.
I don't want you to get to know
me. It's hard.
I like being an enigma.
How do you sum up how you feel about your dad in a 30-second soundbite?
Some of the best memories of my life were with my dad.
I really respect you as a person.
You've always been a hero of mine. I don't think I've ever told you, because it's not easy to talk about emotional stuff with your dad, but I think you need to know that I love you very, very much, and I respect you more than anything.
My dad always believed in me, even when I didn't believe in myself.
Role model that I could look to become a father myself.
Anytime the brothers would ever pick on me or make me feel sad or anything, you always made a special point to take me out for daddy-daughter dates. And that's always meant so much to me.
Coming out was really difficult. Something that's meant a lot to me, my dad has made a point when I almost felt like it couldn't be talked about, my dad would bring it up. My dad would say, you know, who's the number one supporter of gay pride this year? Delta Airlines. Subtle ways that he supported me, that he loved me, that it was okay that I was gay. That meant a lot to me. Thank you.
Some of the hardest times of my life, you were there for me. And, you know, I know we make fun of you for being a robot and not for having emotion or feelings.
To me, my dad's been almost like a lighthouse.
Whenever I really needed it the most in my life, You were there for me. And
it's unchangeable. It's immovable. It's solid. You can count on it.
The story of my CTR ring.
This is where you should go. This is the goal. This is the standard. This is how you should live, even though you're not quite there yet.
On my 16th birthday, my dad took me out to dinner and said that it was put on by a worthy priesthood holder, and that's who it should be replaced by. And so now that I'm actually at the age where I'm thinking about marriage and
now more than ever that I am a father, I can appreciate everything that you've done, all the patience that you've had and the understanding and the firmness.
I had a wonderful childhood. I didn't have the stresses and obstacles in my life at a young age that other kids that I knew and friends now growing up had.
You did a good job as a dad, and I hope that I can do the same for my son.
I really appreciate that now that I'm a father myself, because when you're a child, you really think that your parents are just superheroes and that they can't do anything wrong, and that's just their nature. I mean, they're not regular people. They don't make mistakes. And now that I am, when I realize that you don't change, but your role in life does. And you have to do the best that you can. And you have to be the person that doesn't make mistakes, that, you know, is as close to perfect as possible, and keep your kids sheltered from as much as you can. And as a father, you did that for me.
And I appreciate the sacrifices. And you know what? Sometimes I whine and bitch and complain. And you know what? That's what kids do. I wasn't always the most obedient child growing up. But you know what? I was the oldest. You were new parents.
I know I've caused you a lot of hard times and a lot of stress and worry and ruined a lot of things in your house. But I think I turned out pretty well in spite of all of that. And I can honestly say it's because of the kind of father that you were for me.
Whenever anybody tells me that I am a good father or that I'm doing good and raising my child, it brings me a lot of gratitude, but I feel like I owe a lot of that to you, because a lot of what I'm doing is just mimicking what I knew as a child.
stories about David Chesworth.
Our memories of Dave, you know, goes back to Orem, when we were growing up with our young families.
I think that Bert single-handedly taught the Chesworth boys some colorful language.
Great friend. Did a lot together when our kids were young.
My favorite time with him recently was going on top of the mountain. As we went, he said, "Oh, let's take a little drive." And I said, "Well,
what do you two look like when you're walking together? You know, you look like, you know, I mean, that's
always been better when we're in the truck together. We're like a little more equal."
Very cool truck.
Both Dave and Linda have been wonderful friends over the years.
But he said, "Let's go on a drive." And so we kept driving and driving. And finally, we came to a mountain. And he said, "Let's go up there." And there was a little trail, and he said, "Okay, I can do that," because he was playing with his new four-wheel truck. And we went up and 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 up.
I bet he didn't let you drive.
No.
One time I walked up to his door, it was a Saturday morning, to get him for something, and all of a sudden across his head he had this little mark. And I says, "Dave, I've always wondered, what, you know, what's that mark? I mean, I've never noticed it before." And he said, it was some brain surgery I had. And I said, "Really?" And he said, "No, I just got back from the temple." Dave was always a jokester. Matter of fact, our garbage can was hit by a car once. And what Dave did, he went and bought us a brand new garbage can and put a bullseye on it.
What memories do we have? Water skiing in Texas. That was fun.
You remember the move from Phoenix, David, when you were assigned the Ryder truck that showed it only had a half a tank of gas? But we convinced you that it was full and the gas gauge surely was defective until we got just this side of Logandale and the gas gauge turned out to be correct. There we sat in the heat of the summer. The diesel wouldn't start. And we made four or five trips back and forth to the phone to try and get roadside help.
Tyson was, was he 12?
He was 3.
Oh, okay, he was 3 years old. and we were all water skiing, and Tyson goes, "I have to go to the bathroom, I have to go pee." And you said, "Oh, just go in the lake." So, you know, thinking to jump in the water and go pee, but instead he stood on the side of the boat, dropped his drawers, and proceeded to pee off the side of your boat, which you got a lovely picture, by the way. Now, Tyson, show my little tech now. Let's do another rendition of that. Stand up.
He always liked to climb mountains or hills. Even when he was about 18 months old, I caught him climbing up a high lattice in the neighbor's yard.
My brother's always had the spirit of adventure.
when he and Richard climbed Mount Whitney, it was almost fatal.
We didn't know ahead of time that you were supposed to get passes if you wanted to camp on the mountain. And so we had to go the 11 miles up and the 11 miles back in one day.
Ooh.
Because we are always prepared for whatever adventures we go on.
As a pilot, he went snowblind and wore blinders or coverings for his eyes for several days.
I got a little bit of altitude sickness and threw up on the trail in the snow.
But he did climb to the top of Mount Whitney.
I always remember my brother being fun and full of adventure. And I hope that doesn't change now that you're an old man.
Lake Dangerfield. And it was like a weekend. We took off on a Friday night. It was probably like a 4 or 5 hour drive. And we got up to the campsite and had a little bit of trouble getting the campfire going. So Uncle Dave decided, well, no, it just needs more fuel. So he put some on, still had some trouble getting it going. Well, let's just put a little more fuel on. So he finally got it going. And I would say the flames were probably 25, 30 feet. And all the other campers were staring in amazement, thinking, this guy's lighting up the whole forest. But it was a great while it lasted, and it didn't burn any trees down, and it did die down after a few minutes, but they knew we were there.
Congratulations. Wow, 50. It's really getting up there. Surprised you made it this long, counting the way that you drive. I remember when we all went down to visit Jeff at Lackland, and you were going like 500 miles an hour down a two-lane road, weaving in and out of traffic. That stuff's okay in the air, but on the ground it can make us all a little nervous. Anyway, I'm just kidding. I just wanted to let you know that me and Jace are so blessed to have you in our life.
Through the years, you have been so good to me. You would always give me a ticket so I could fly out to see you and Linda and the kids. Or you would send Linda to me. You've always been so thoughtful and so good, not just to Linda, but to me. And I love you dearly for it. You have been just like a son to me. You haven't been a son-in-law.
My daughters have always said that they were going to go out and find a man in the world like David, you know. And so, you know, that used to embarrass you, but I want you to know now that you're this old, 15 years old, that it is really a good thing when young women use you as an ensign on how to choose mate.
And they think you're much more sexy because you're an airline pilot.
That's true. Captain, oh my captain.
I get up about 20 feet off the ground and you get up about 20,000 and that makes you higher.
What else do you remember? Oh, the Christmas letters.
Yes, we love the humorous Christmas letters every year. Except for last year.
Yeah.
You need to start doing that.
Yes, you need to redo that. So from now on, Christmas letters, all the funny things in them. You know, making fun of your kids and everybody else. Mainly your kids.
Mainly making fun of your kids.
Yeah, that's great.
We appreciated that.
Yeah.
He told me once, he says, I wear my captain's hat at work and it makes me important. And when I come home, she makes me take out the trash. So.
Can we erase this?
Well, I thought we're not done telling stories.
Yes, we are.
We remember the pictures of the first presidency that were in your home at that time, Dave, and how your story about how people would come in the house and ask you if those were your grandpas or your grandparents.
That always impressed us so much that when we returned back from our vacation, we always thought it was important that as people entered our entry in our home, they were able to see pictures of the temple or the prophets or something. And so that's always a lasting impression.
Happy birthday, big guy. I love you.
We love you, big guy. Come and see us.
We were delighted when the two of you decided to come back to Utah and move out here. We've been able to see you a little bit more. Not as much as we'd like, but again, true friends. Appreciate your friendship and help when we need it. It's nice to have a brother close by with a truck as we move children in and out of our home and hopefully mostly out. You've been a blessing in our life as you know, we've grown and matured. We've known each other for 20-something years and look forward to doing many more things in the future. Thanks a lot, Dave, and happy birthday.